My dearly beloved in Christ, you know today again is the Feast of the Most Holy Rosary, and the entire month of October is the month of the Holy Rosary. And it is important for us to reflect upon the value, the importance of this devotion of the Holy Rosary. It is interesting that when Our Lady appeared at Fatima, every single time she appeared, six apparitions altogether, every time she requested the daily recitation of the rosary. And in fact, the children, Lucia asked her name. And Our Lady said, in October, on the apparition in October, I will tell you who I am. So what name did she use? She said, I am the Lady of the Rosary, indicating her appreciation for the value of the Holy Rosary. There's an interesting quotation from an interview with Sister Lucia, one of the three children to whom Our Lady appeared, with a priest, Father Fuentes, in 1957. And I've mentioned this before, but it really strikes me what Lucia said. She said, the Most Holy Virgin, in these last times in which we live, has given a new efficacy to the recitation of the rosary, to such an extent that there is no problem, no matter how difficult it is, whether temporal or above all spiritual, in the personal life of each one of us, of our families, of the families of the world, or of the religious communities, or even of the life of peoples and nations, that cannot be solved by the rosary. There is no problem, I tell you, no matter how difficult it is, that we cannot resolve by the prayer of the Holy Rosary. And so that is interesting what she said, that God and Our Lady have given to the Rosary in our times a greater efficacy, a greater value than this prayer had in times in the past. Simply because we are surrounded by so many spiritual dangers, so many occasions of sin. And God can certainly do what He will. And so He has chosen to give a greater spiritual value to the recitation of the rosary than was the case in times past. And over the years, over the centuries, since Our Lady first gave the rosary to Saint Dominic in the 13th century, since then, there have been many wonderful graces and miracles attributed to the rosary. To come to our own times, there's a very interesting miracle that took place in 1945, August 6th to be exact, and that was the dropping of the atom bomb on Hiroshima, Japan. And of course, the area was entirely devastated. The buildings were flattened to the ground. The people were killed. Even those at a distance suffered from radiation and perhaps died later. But there was a house, a rectory, where eight Jesuit priests were living that was completely untouched. And it was only eight blocks from ground zero. Right next to the rectory was a church that was completely destroyed. And not only was the building spared, but all eight priests who were living in that building were spared. They had no hearing loss. They had no effects of radiation. And scientists couldn't figure that out. One priest said, we were interviewed at least 200 times over the years because they lived full lives. And his comment was, the only explanation I can give is that in that house, we were taking seriously the request of Our Lady at Fatima to pray the rosary every day. And we prayed the rosary every day faithfully. And they were preserved again from the death and destruction of the atom bomb. In 1955, the Russian communists withdrew from Austria. Now, after the Second World War, the Russians were given all of the Eastern Bloc countries, including Austria. And the tanks of the Russian Soviet army rolled into Austria. They took over the country. and a Franciscan priest decided what we need is a rosary crusade. And he promoted this for the people in Austria to pray the rosary. By the thousands, the tens of thousands, people signed a pledge to pray the rosary every day for the defeat of communism and that the communists would leave their country. And without a shot being fired, without a person killed, on May the 13th, 1955, the anniversary of Our Lady's first apparition at Fatima, the communist authorities signed the agreement to leave the country and they simply left. The same thing happened in 1962 in Brazil. The government of that country was turning communist. There was a danger for the entire country, a Catholic country, to become communist. And a woman decided, we need a rosary crusade. This was spread throughout the country, especially among the women. And they turned out in the streets and marched in processions and prayed the rosary. In the capital, there were 600,000 that came out on one occasion to pray the rosary. And again, the communism was defeated. The country was spared the scourge of communism because of the rosary. But another miracle that is the reason why we celebrate the Feast of the Rosary on October the 13th was the Battle of Lepanto. And to properly understand the significance of the Battle of Lepanto, we have to realize that the forces of Islam had great naval superiority for centuries in the Mediterranean. Many thousands, tens of thousands of Christians were arrested and taken away to the Muslim countries of North Africa or of the Middle East, of Turkey, that area, as slaves by Muslim pirates. They would come unexpected and land on the shore in Italy or Spain or wherever and attack and sack the town and take people away into captivity. There were two religious orders founded in the 13th century or thereabouts for the redemption of captives. And imagine the pitiable state of these Christians who were taken captive by the Muslims. Most likely they would never see a priest again, they would never see their families again, never have a chance to receive the sacraments for the rest of their lives, and have to live a miserable life of slavery. And so this was a terrible scourge. Now, the final cause that led the Christians, and the Pope in particular, to gather and unite the Christian forces and to go forth and do battle with the Muslims was the siege of the island of Cyprus, and in particular, the town of Famagusta, which was a colony, you might say, of the Venetians. And the Muslims surrounded it, and finally, the commander of this town, of this harbor, agreed to surrender, and the Muslim leader said, you will all be spared and you'll be allowed to return to Venice, just simply surrender. Well, he was so angry because he had lost so many soldiers after they surrendered, that commander was flayed alive and his body was hung up on the ship of the Sultan. And the Pope at that time was Pope St. Pius V. And he united the Christians who were often bitterly opposed to one another, united them into what was called the Holy League. And together there were about 200 ships that were gathered together from Venice, from Spain, from Naples, from Genoa, from different cities and different duchies and kingdoms. And the Holy League went forth in September of 1571. And Pope St. Pius V, who was behind this enterprise, encouraged Catholics to pray the rosary. He, being a Dominican pope, greatly devoted to the rosary, would walk the streets of Rome praying his rosary, teaching by word and example. And finally, the Christian fleet met the Muslim fleet on the morning of October the 7th, 1571, outside the harbor of Lepanto in Greece. Altogether, there were about 400 ships. The Christian fleet was composed of 212 vessels, 40,000 sailors and oarsmen and 25,000 troops. The Turks had about 300 vessels, 37,000 oarsmen, 13,000 sailors, and 34,000 troops. The Christians, however, had slightly more artillery. But the Muslims had experience, more ships, more men, etc. The wind was against the Christian fleet, and right before noon, the wind shifted in their favor. And it was about noon that the two fleets, the two armadas, joined forces. At the end, the Christians had captured 137 vessels of the enemy and sank 50 others. The Sultan had been killed that was in charge. 10,000 Turks were taken prisoners. There were 7,500 deaths among the Christians, but four times that among the Turks. 30,000 Turks were killed. And that ended, once for all, the supremacy of these Islamic pirates throughout the Mediterranean. There were still problems, but that ended it. And what was interesting is when the battle was won, Pope St. Pius V, in his study in Rome, knew that the Christians had gained a victory, that the battle had taken place that day, and the Christians had obtained a victory. And he declared that day, October the 7th, the Feast of Our Lady of Victory. Well, later, the name of the feast was changed to Our Lady of the Rosary, and fittingly so. But it's not just material or temporal graces and victories that are obtained by the recitation of the rosary. The most important thing is the spiritual benefits, the graces. How many conversions the recitation of the rosary has brought about, and how many Catholics have persevered and saved their souls because of their fidelity to the recitation of the rosary. That's much more important than temporal triumphs or victories. And it can be said, I believe safely said, in the age in which we live, that we will not persevere without the graces obtained from the faithful recitation of the rosary. And I'd like to quote to you a little bit from a book which has a little bit of a strange title. The title of the book, by a Jesuit priest, Father Hugh Thwaites, is Our Glorious Faith and How to Lose It. And what this book is about is how people have lost their faith. And this is his primary conclusion. Is, he says, the abandonment of the family rosary is a main reason why so many Catholics have lost the faith. And he tells a story of a man, a friend of his told him about a man who was such an outstanding Catholic man, he was the pillar of his parish. But all of his children lost their faith, one after another, stopped going to Mass, lost their faith. And the priest said to the man who told him this, he said, I'm willing to bet that when that man was a boy, growing up, his family prayed the rosary. And that's why he's so strong in his faith. But I'm willing to bet that his family, his own family, did not pray the rosary, and that's why his children lost the faith. So this man went back to his friend to inquire if that might by any chance be true. And the man said, oh yes, when I was growing up, our family prayed the rosary every day. And after I got married and had my own family, we prayed the rosary every day. But one day, we were about to start the rosary, and one of the children got up and walked up and turned on the television. And we watched a program, and that was that. From that point on, they no longer prayed the family rosary. So it's not enough to pray the rosary, but especially families must pray the rosary together. Now, if that's just two people, then those two people should pray the rosary together, remembering the words of our Lord, where two or three are gathered together, I am there in the midst of them. So there's an added value to praying the rosary together with your fellow parishioners before Mass on Sunday. And for families, the members of the family, to pray the rosary together, not just individually. So this is the month of the Holy Rosary, and today the Feast of the Holy Rosary. Let us rededicate ourselves to faithfulness in praying the rosary every day as Our Lady requested, and especially to pray it with attention and devotion, with meditation on the mysteries, trusting in our Blessed Mother, the mediatrix of all graces, that thereby she will obtain for us all the graces we need to persevere and save our souls. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen.